Ranching is one of the toughest occupations.
Come on, calf, get up in there.
And one of the most enjoyable.
A lot of ranchers, they don't do it for the business, they do it for the lifestyle.
It's tough because it's physically challenging.
Come on.
Mentally challenging.
You have to try and manage and operate so many acres and so many head of cattle to make a living now.
And the financial pressures are great.
On bad years, dry years, big payments, they'll get you down.
But they love it.
You're kind of your own boss, and I like it out here.
Which, most days, makes it worth all the headaches and sacrifice.
You know, you don't get a new car every year, but you do get a sunset every single night.
Because it's not an occupation. It's a tradition, a heritage. It's an inheritance most ranchers are born into. Today, ranchers are developing new traditions in order to keep their inheritance alive, creating a new heritage for the future of ranching.
This program was brought to you with a grant from the United States Department of Agriculture, Rural Development, and by the members of Prairie Public.
I always wanted to be a rancher, and I guess I am today.
Push up! Ho! Push up! Push up! Whoop! Whoop!
Anyway, today was a real proud day.
You're going in good.
This day is the one many ranchers look forward to. They get to see the fruits of their labors. The new calf crop is rounded up.
It's just a fun time. It's kind of in between cabin and hen, and I always did love it. My daughters love it. They can't wait to get out and ride and just get out and run around and play with the kids and just be kids.
Can you handle them, buddy?
I was the same way, maybe a little wilder.
Shane Wolf's family has been ranching this land near Golden Valley, North Dakota, since his grandfather settled here in 1922.
I think they picked a nice location, my grandpa. He raised a family here, and so did my dad. And
put your brand on your calf.
Now it's my kids, and they want a ranch too, so. Who knows, it's probably four generations, especially with them boys looking at my daughters.
Got about 30-some calves here already. If we can get them heifers off, that's great.
The guy had some tough years. A lot of people out there think that that ranching is a glorious life. It is, but a lot of times you don't have a lot of dollars in your pocket. Like I tell my kids, I always tell them, the hell with the money.
This here's a pretty good calf here. He's pretty deep.
It was easy to make a living all the way through the 70s, and come the early 80s with high interest, and we had some droughts. 1980s real bad, the year I graduated, and my brother and I, we had a little financial trouble and fought back and hit another drought, and hit storms, and fought back again. And through all those years, you wonder why in the hell you're here.
You still got that marker?
People out there that don't put 100% in, they probably won't make it. You gotta like what you do and be good at it. It is what you make it, too. If you're an optimist and smile, things will turn out. You can't be a quitter, and I'm not.
Preserve a traditional value, you must change a traditional practice. And so to take that little bit of wisdom and put it into reality, that people need to understand that there has to be some change.
The Hansons have given up a little of the traditional ranching life in order to keep their family's heritage alive. To improve their ranching operation, they've given up some privacy by inviting people to visit what they call the Logging Camp Ranch.
One dream I had always had as a youth was to build a log cabin.
This was the first one. It's pretty cozy. I got a wood-burning stove. People like to come here and just chill out.
Our intent was to create a place in the wintertime where we could stay warm, a place to store all our tools, keep things dry, you know, and get organized and all of that kind of thing. Well, before we had the roof finished, people were inquiring about renting it.
And of course, then when people wanted to rent this building, in a minute or two, I realized there was the land use. Because the ranch is a beautiful ranch. Beef cattle buyers and wheat buyers don't have any bias on how beautiful a ground the animals were grown on, you know. But having cabins and services, that was how we could prosper from what the country looks like and smells like and sounds like and all that stuff. It changed my life, and it was because then I realized that I could just darn well do anything I set my mind to. What's called the Ranger Rosa. Well, it sleeps 25. We have this common kitchen area, in this eating area and meeting area. There's a full loft with a bathroom and bedroom suite upstairs in the loft.
We've eventually now created an enterprise that is by no means an empire, but we have 44 beds in four separate buildings.
Their ranch is smack dab in the middle of some of the prettiest land on earth, the North Dakota Badlands. Today, the Badlands' greatest value may not be as a home for cattle, but for wildlife.
A wild ringneck is worth more on the hoof to a farmer or rancher than is a feeder pig, or in a profit sense, more than a slaughter lamb. And so it's only natural that people would see right away that they should be managing their land in a more diversified way, which may include hunting.
The birds will be in this brush and habitat along the creek and the river. That's where they'll be. All the way up to where the machine.
The Hansons see this as a natural transition for their operation, and a necessary one.
I think they're in here. Got a point.
You can see that tail on there. The first ringneck bow hunting combo that we sold, there was a group of 10 hunters. In 1 week's time, I spent probably 8 hours.
Good boy.
Taking care of selling the trip, and then once the people got here, getting them oriented to the habitat and checking in with them periodically through the week. But we netted pretty close to $8,000 for that 8 hours works.
Good boy.
So that would be approximately the profit on 60 beef cows for the entire year. And the hours involved in an entire year to take care of 60 head of beef cows. Oh, man.
Hen!
Okay. Good boy, Jim. Good boy, Jimmy.
We'll walk up this way, and then I'll cross over and go up that way there.
We've always said that if feeder cattle were $3 a pound and wheat $10 a bushel, there would be no such thing as an agriculturally based recreational industry in the state.
It could be up on these side hills right through here.
The recreational industry, in a rural sense, is growing because there is very small potential for profit in conventional agricultural production.
Well, he was right. There were birds in here. There's tracks all down through here. Come on, Jim. Up.
In conventional agriculture, ranchers take care of a herd of cows and sell their calves. That used to bring in enough money to feed a ranch family. Today, it takes more. More acres, more cattle, and probably more income from outside jobs. Some say success in cattle production is all a matter of good breeding.
We produce grass, is what we produce. Cows are basically our factory that harvests the grass, and they convert it to the calf and the milk, and the calf is how we market our grass, by selling the calf.
Traditionally, ranchers raised just one or two breeds. Jeff Dahl and his family mixed breeds to build in qualities that will give them a premium price. They've even developed their own, called Dakota Red, which carries the traits of four breeds. Dahl's goal is creating nothing short of perfection.
The perfect cow. One that'll calve on her own, milk well, has good feet and legs, good muscling, feed efficient.
Hey, calf. Hey, calf. Get in there. Hey, calf. Keep going.
Ranchers, like the Dahls, are trying to produce the kind of meat people want, but that gets tricky. Consumers have been saying they want leaner meats, so ranchers have been breeding leaner calves. But then their calves get discounted at the sales ring for not having enough fat. What gives?
73.50.
It turns out what the customer will still pay the most for is a nice, juicy steak at a restaurant.
See, at one point they were going, we don't want fat, but in order to get the taste, they need some fat, and so we're kind of trying to fine-tune it. Grass-fed beef is maybe on the horizon. It's gaining a little popularity in certain segments of the country. There's been people that haven't eaten beef for years that, well, it's not grain-fed, and there's no hormones. So they're coming back to eating some beef.
Extension beef specialist Dr. Greg Lardy says ranchers shouldn't follow consumer fads too closely.
Because with the generation interval in cattle, if we buy these bulls today and they're the lean beef kind of products that you think the consumer wants, by the time you market calves from them, it could be 2 or 3 years down the road, and so consumers may have changed their mind by then.
Come on, guys, turn around.
Even more than the changing whims of consumers, what frustrates ranchers is that someone else sets the price they get for their calf.
Hey, guys. Step up there, boys. Some people say the retailer's getting too much. Some people think the packer is. Cow-calf producers kind of on a take it or leave it sometimes. You know. What do you give me for my calf instead of... You go buy anything in the store, and it's marked, price is marked on it, so. Come on, fellas.
So ranchers are trying to find ways to set their own prices.
Heck yeah.
Rather than going through the traditional sales ring, the Dahls market their calves through an alliance. The alliance imposes tight controls on how producers raise the calves, but can lead to a good premium price.
There's potential there if you've got the right cattle to do really well. But the first year you're in it, until you've done it one time, you don't know what kind of cattle you have, so you have to be in it more than 1 year. I mean, you can go in there and really get your butts kicked the first time. But then if you make the right changes, you can turn it around within 3 years, and you should be able to really start realizing some profit from it. I think the future is pretty bright. I think the producer that stays on top of things, knows what it costs them to produce his calves, and follows some of these different ways of marketing their calves can be pretty profitable in this business.
According to my figures, we'll have 84 calves and 2 cows to put on the truck here.
Hey. Shh.
That's 12 here. Get up there.
It's so fast-paced, and you have to be so big. You have to try and manage and operate so many acres and so many head of cattle to make a living now compared to when I was a kid. I mean, people struggled when I was a kid too, but it just seemed like a slower pace. And we didn't have to operate such big places.
Kevin Fugere's parents raised a large family ranching 1,200 acres. Kevin and his wife Cindy run cattle on 12,000, and they still need outside family income.
There's very few people that don't have an outside income anymore. No matter how big their ranch is or how many cattle they feed.
In order to operate a large operation like this, you need to be married to your operation. You have to be home. So to be off the farm to earn cash is almost convoluted. It's the wrong thing to do. You may earn a little cash, but fences will decline and buildings will decline and things won't get done. It's a big operation. It takes all of us.
Cindy used to work in Bismarck and commute to the farm on weekends. When they bought land a few years ago that had an old homestead, they decided to fix it up. They call it Camel's Hump Lodge for the nearby butte with the same name. The Fugers are hoping the lodge will provide the extra income they need so Cindy won't have to work away from home.
When you went up to check the cattle, you took the time to watch a sunset. And I guess that's how we came to realize maybe other people would love it, because we did. It's the transition between prairie and badlands. Lots of beautiful hardwood draws and rolling hills, scoria and clay and green grass and wide open spaces. And at night, there's nothing prettier than Camel's Hump because there's no lights for miles. And so you see the night sky. I had quit working, and Kevin thought it would be a good thing for me to do, to take on a small enterprise that would allow us to work out of our home. So I spent a couple summers fixing it up, hired a few contractors to do a little work, and now it's an old farmhouse that we call a guest home. This business is a sacrifice financially too, because everything that you make, you put back into it. And the profit margins are minimal. And the debt load is intense at all times of the year, especially when you own land, but also all the inputs that you put into the crops and the cattle. And so you have to like to live without some things that other people have. You know, you don't get a new car every year, but you do get a sunset every single night.
He still prays at sunrise, asking the Creator to bless the day, praying that this year there will be enough hay. He lopes his war horse across the prairies, hunting elusive cattle. Surviving in today's modern world is his new battle. He rides in ropes and rodeos to prove his courage and skills. If he wins, he can pay a few more bills. His paint and feathers have been replaced by chaps and spurs, but he is still a warrior, minus his arrows and furs.
Like a deer or something like that.
Kyle and Stacy Baker ranch on the Fort Berthold Indian Reservation. Kyle says ranching was a natural way for Native Americans to keep their traditions alive.
In the old days on the TV, you'd see all the cowboys against the Indians, all, you know, and us were kind of a mix, the cowboys and the Indians. In this one book I was reading on Native American ranchers and cowboys, it says, Indians became cowboys to remain Indians. I think what they meant was, you know, you're around the horses, you're out on the land, you take care of the land, hunting elusive cattle, you're riding, you're out there, you know. And just like this poem says, is we just crossed over because almost to maintain our way of life, which was gone. before the cattle ranchers came, our people had horses here, and we used them for everything. They're almost sacred to us. They seen ranching as a way of keeping the horses, not having to move to town, and see if you have cattle, you gotta have horses. And they just kind of jumped right into that ranching stuff because we were horse people anyway. And then the rodeo stuff started. That was, they were warriors, and they liked that bravery stuff, so they got right into that too. Not only this, but Navajos, Apaches, Cheyennes, Sioux, they assimilated right into that ranching. And they picked up those cowboy traditions, but they held on to the Indian traditions too. My grandfather was an interpreter for the stockmen. His name was Jim Baker, my dad's father. He was an interpreter for the stockmen and the Indians. But on my mother's side, it goes even further back, another generation. We were related to just about all the ranches on Fort Berthel, and all the rodeo cowboys are all related to through our family.
You got a hot iron?
Kyle's family first ran cattle on the lush grasses of the river bottom. They were forced to give up that land to provide flood control for others. Their land now lies under Lake Sakakawea.
They ranched along the river bottoms, and then when the dam came, they had to relocate up to Mandaree, our old place. Up on top here, it's pretty good grazing, but there's no shelter, not much water. And when my dad took his cattle up, when they first moved up, 2 days later they went to check those cattle and they all went back to the old place. They didn't like it up on them flats. Like before that dam came, our reservation was like 90-some% farm and ranch. There was no welfare. Everybody worked, everybody had gardens, everybody worked together. They ranched, they farmed. There was no fences, and this guy needed help branding, so everybody went and branded. This guy was missing some cows, so neighbors went and helped bring the cows back. Or they had to move cows, they worked together. And they just worked together in almost harmony. The dam split us up, and now we're so far apart, and there's fences everywhere. But we still try to work together. I work and my wife works. We found we just about had to.
You see where the little black?
I seen a thing on this big rancher down and on TV. And he says, on November 20th, we sell calves. November 21st, we pay the bank. November 22nd, we go back to bank and borrow more money to operate, And we don't want to do that, We don't want to just keep borrowing money and paying back the same money. We want to make money. When we did ranch, I didn't have a degree yet, and Stacy didn't have a degree, and we seen all these people around us with making a lot of money with these degrees, so we went back and got our degrees. And with that, we start putting our salaries into the ranch. And when we did that, we could keep more calves back in the fall. We could increase our herd, like our panels, tractor, everything we buy with our paychecks right now, until we get our herd big enough to where it'll support itself. And it's getting close to that now.
Hey, hey.
My goal in life is to build a cow herder to a point to where we don't need that extra income.
Donald and Sarah Nordby run an artificial insemination business to supplement their ranch income. They both look forward to the day they can just ranch.
In ranching or farming, you're always cash poor. People see the total dollars that we generate. But, in terms of cash flow and actually having cash available, all of our money's tied up in those tractors and equipment and livestock. And if you're buying and in the land or the fence, it's all tied up in that. So you kind of live day to day on a cash flow basis.
That's what keeps a person going, that next year is going to be better. And you kind of see the light at the end of the tunnel. Okay, we're going to get these things paid off, and then you can go on to the next project or the next phase.
When Donald and Sarah took over the Nordby family ranch, Sarah was working in ag marketing, and Donald was with the Extension Service.
I don't know, a lot of guys, friends of mine, that when I quit and came back to ranch, thought I was pretty stupid, but giving up a pretty good job to come out here and to break even. In university and system, it's all theory, and it's not much applied anymore. It's a lot more basic research if you're a professor. So in the real world, things don't always go the way the book. It took about 4 years to beat my college education out of me here.
If you're going to feed a grain supplement, the other thing you should be doing is feeding it every day.
But the Nordbys do keep up with beef production research and use some of the latest technology to improve their operation.
166.
There's the calf, see? There's his head right there. We'll measure that.
91 to 96 days, you know.
What we're doing is ultrasounding checking for pregnancies. The theory is you can find your opens and sell them before the calf market goes to hell in the fall.
This heifer's open?
That's correct. Another
open?
Yes.
Yeah, I'd mark her. Well, that's not good. Why winter them if they don't have a calf in them? And I don't know, we're short feed this year, so my light end, I'm probably going to take up to my father-in-law's in Hazen's and have them backgrounded there. So, you know, when we wean, we'll hold them here for 30 days, let them get through the stress of weaning and get them started on feed, and then I'll, rather than to buy the feed and bring it here, I'm just going to take the cattle where the feed's at this year. Hey.
These last years haven't been too bad as far as rain is concerned, but when there's no grass, well then, that takes a lot of the fun out of it.
I grew up here, and this ranch basically ran, the deeded ground that my father owns would run between 60 to 80 cows and about 300 acres a week. And Dad, through the late 50s, 60s, and 70s, raised three kids and college educated all of us on that. Today, 60 cows and 300 acres of wheat, we'd be on food stamps.
There you go.
I guess I believe in the future of ranching, but I think some drastic things have got to change for it to be sustainable. Like owning your product all the way to a consumer. Is it capturing more of that retail dollar and bringing it back?
1-5 yellow.
It's market, market, market. We as producers, we just can't sit on these ranches anymore and let someone else do our marketing.
I think this is 1-126 is the first one.
The closer I can get to the consumer with my cattle before I run into a middleman or someone else that handles the product, it makes it more efficient. And in the money we save, I, as a rancher, probably not going to get all of it. Maybe the consumer gets a break on what he pays for the product also.
183.
Nordby has worked on 4 equity drives to create beef cooperatives where ranchers would join together to slaughter their own cattle and sell the meat.
We all fell short to raise enough money to meet our escrow to be able to do the project. And it seems like every time you fail, the next time you come out, it just adds ammunition to the naysayer that says, well, see, I told you it wasn't going to work. People have put their money in them, and they've lost it. And it's pretty tough to convince someone, well, I already tried that. You know, I took a $10,000 hickey. I'm not going to take another one. And it's almost to the point now to where I think for it to happen is that there's got to be additional involvement other than the rancher to reduce the risk enough for the rancher that he can get in and see it working, or at least a demonstration of it working, to where then it can be commercialized and then and move forward from there. But it's to the point now, I think, to really get something going, you're gonna have to show me that attitude. Show me it works, then I'm in.
A cattleman from North Dakota's past also had trouble getting a meatpacking business started in the Badlands. The Marquis de Moras wasn't interested in tradition or heritage. To the French nobleman, ranching looked like a good investment in the late 1800s.
He wanted to make a lot of money, and cattle was the way to do it. So he came west and decided on this spot because his cousin had been out here hunting and had given glowing reports of it. He thought he could slaughter them here and eliminate the middleman. He eventually wanted to own his own butcher shops in the big cities on the East Coast. So he would have a vertical business from beginning to end.
But the Marquis had several problems.
He had very tough competition from the Chicago Packers. Chicago by that time had become the leader in meatpacking and slaughtering. So he was fighting them, and of course they didn't want to give up anything they had. He was listening to the boom reports of this area, where there was plenty of rain, hardly ever got cold, hardly ever snowed, thinking that the grass would be very plentiful. And the first year was fine. 1885, there was a drought. 1886 was even worse. And by that time, there was overgrazing on the range so that the cattle weren't ready to head into a hard winter, and that was the hardest winter on record, 1886 and 1887. So that winter, it put most of the cattlemen out of business. There were a few who were able to get additional financing to come back and buy up remnants of herds, but most of them just packed it up and left, including the Marquis.
The Marquis lost over $1 million. In today's dollars, that could translate to $10 million. Ragnar says some point to the Chicago meatpackers as a force behind the failure.
Nothing is documented, though there are many stories that abound, that they paid people to sideline the cars, the refrigerator cars, or paid people not to ice them instead of to ice them. We don't know if this happened. It could have been incompetence on the part of the workers that some of that happened, or maybe there was some shenanigans going on.
Large-scale producer-owned meat processing projects have met with limited success in North Dakota. But some small family operations seem to be working.
It's our buffalo jalapeno stick. It's not hot or anything, it's just for to flavor.
One example is Big Sky Buffalo. There's no doubt succeeding at selling your own products involves having a vision of what you want to accomplish. But part of Big Sky Buffalo's strategy is just try it.
If the buffalo steak per pound prices are right there.
There's risks to anything, really. Sometimes we've only jumped in with one foot, and sometimes we've jumped in with both. So if it works out, it works out great. And if it doesn't, well, we learn from our mistakes and try it a different way.
Here's your receipts. Thank you very much.
Angie Bachmeier's grandfather added buffalo to his cattle herd in the early 1980s. The neighbors started asking for buffalo meat, which led them to start marketing the product.
We have a shop right on Main Street in Granville. We have all of our buffalo meat and buffalo leather products available here, so people can come in and do their shopping and pick up some buffalo meat or jerky or whatever. We have everything available right here. We also use the internet. It's been very helpful for us. We probably do right now about 80% of our business over the internet. And we also do truckload sales around North Dakota and into Minnesota.
Hello there.
Hi, you got in the way of a roast.
We have hump roast, sirloin tip, chuck roast.
We have different little restaurants and grocery stores that carry our product around the area. We do Pride of Dakota shows, other different agricultural-based shows also.
Two, did you want smaller ones or larger ones?
Two and a half pounds.
Okay.
As a small family-based business, Big Sky Buffalo has the flexibility to experiment with different cuts of meat and marinades.
Yeah, we're always out looking through different cookbooks and stuff. We just started doing choke cherry and Cajun marinated steaks. This spring we started that. We're kind of really pushing those with our Lewis and Clark and Sakakawea assortments. Pretty much we sell anything and everything. We've had calls for hearts, tongues, we sell those quite regularly. Rocky Mountain oysters are really popular. So we have 8 different jerkies. We sell a ton of jerky.
Okay, the 2 roasts shipped, okay.
Takes time, it's not gonna happen overnight. So you just have to keep working at it, and there's gonna be doors slammed in your face, but you just have to keep at it. It'll pay off in the end.
Thank you very much.
Come on! Come on!
We're raising protein now,
We have diversified that much that it's not beef for cattle anymore, it's protein.
Come on!
Terry and Linda Dammel have been talking about selling beef products since they got married about 20 years ago.
And we knew that what we were selling wasn't going to sustain the price that we were at that time, so we decided, well, why not hedge ourselves a little bit and make jerky, or at least research the potential of making products out of what we raise.
Here's the other prime rib with the lip.
The Dammels began selling some of their premium cuts to restaurants, including the bistro in Bismarck.
Do you have any use for New Yorks?
Well, remember, the two steaks I run are New Yorks and fillets.
Oh, is that right?
The two steaks I use here.
But they needed markets for the whole carcass.
Through our research, we started to evolve more into the jerkies and the beef sticks, and then the refrigerated products that we did just kind of followed after that. We're always working on something different. One of your greatest educations you can get is just walk through the grocery store. Watch what they buy, what goes in their carts.
We've developed sort of a scalp potato with our smoked beef. One of the other products that we have is our smoked beef used in a white sauce. We were looking for a lot of breakfast entrees, and the smoked beef does work very well as a breakfast entree with toast. I think a lot of people have different names for it.
Oh, yep, still mild, that's 24.
The Dammels started small and used their own cash. Now, they need to get their volume up to a point where they can produce enough product to sell in larger quantities.
The volume part and the cash is getting to be more of a struggle because of our limited labor capacity, and myself and Linda and our two kids. If we can get connected with a food processor that does this already, would either help us or do it for us, that we could get this into the marketplace.
If their Rolling Hills premium beef grows big enough, they may eventually get out of ranching altogether.
Well, we hope that we can quit the ranching industry and move directly into marketing. You know, we have liquidated quite a few already, and to get back in, you know, I'm almost 50. I've done other things, I would like to do other things, and this was one of my passions, was beef products. If that can't get up to volume or to speed for it to sustain us in a salary-based position, I guess the 9-to-5 doesn't look so bad. The ranching is a nice profession, and it's a good profession, but I don't think it can sustain family farms much longer.
Come on!
A lot of ranchers, they don't do it for the business, they do it for the lifestyle. And I think that's probably a true statement for everybody who sacrifices to live out here. But it's, I think, like they said, the cowboy's a dying breed, so are the ranchers, the true rancher.
It's a wonderful place to raise a family and to live. But for us to encourage our son or our daughter to continue this on, we don't feel that it's something we want to do.
Well, it's a third generation ranch. They always said it was hardest on the one that had to leave, and you know, you have to make that decision. If you can't survive here, you got to do something else.
It's not just the future of the farm that's important, but the future of the family, because there is no family farm without speaking of family first in rural America.
Most every rancher will tell you they love the life they live, but their business can be one of the most stressful. There are so many things they can't control. The weather, the markets. It's easy to find something to lose sleep over.
The stress they're experiencing is, can I carry on this family legacy that's been bequeathed to me by a grandfather or a great-grandfather or an uncle? and this sense of obligation to carry it on for my posterity and for future generations. This is chronic stress over a long period of time, and it becomes debilitating. Their relationships sometimes becomes more challenging. Their physical health often suffers. People are more prone to get into behavioral health challenges. They're trying to cope. They may be more likely to seek escape at the local bar. Depression levels increase significantly. People dealing with anger problems, and sometimes that comes out in terms of violence within family relationships.
The high stress levels in farmers and ranchers are reflected in recent North Dakota census data that suggests about a 35% increase in divorce over the last decade.
What's interesting about that data is it's located particularly in some of the rural areas of the state, some that have been hardest hit by agricultural stress over that period, areas like southwest North Dakota. And so stress is really having the effect of fracturing families. The primary source of support for most people who are in farming and ranching is a spouse. And if that relationship isn't sustained, then it becomes more challenging in a number of significant ways. Once you're able to open those lines of communication and get them feeling that they're working together as a team, then you see stress levels start to drop quite significantly. And I think the one thing that you see that is common with people who cope well with that stress is they don't just hold it in. When you internalize that stress, you just make your life more difficult and the lives of those around you more difficult by not being willing to say, I'm not managing this as well as I could. Who can I turn to, who I can just visit with?
There was a time when ranch families got together on a regular basis. They call it neighboring. But with off-ranch jobs, larger herds, other businesses, neighboring moves lower on the priority list.
We neighbored more then than we do now, even if we had to go with a team.
Rancher Sidney Connell is in his 90s. He remembers a time when neighbors took time to play together.
Oh, picnics and just neighbor, just talking and played a lot. We had card parties and quite often then.
But he also remembers one of the most stressful times for ranchers. The 1930s, when many ranchers lost their land due to the drought.
You know, we've had dry years, but those were the worst I ever saw. We were all broke. They couldn't pay the taxes and the county was broke, and so they come in here. This was a relief project is what it was. They bought this land and they also got our minerals. They shipped most of the cattle out of this area at that time, and there was nothing on that flat where the American Inn is now, except the stockyard. I've seen that whole flat covered with cattle at that time. We got $20 a head for the big cattle, and I think it was $5 for a calf.
The drought of the 30s redefined the lives of ranchers. The government now owned a lot of the land and leased it back to the ranchers. This relationship is volatile at times, especially when the government tries to regulate how the land is managed.
A lot of people think that we're overgrazing and abusing this land. We wouldn't be here if we wanted to abuse it, because you'll cut your own throat if you overgraze. Your cows will be thin, your calves will be light, your cows won't breed back. You have to manage. You can't short your cattle on grass. Most of us are here because we love this land, you know, we like it here. This is a beautiful country. We don't want to wreck it.
Now a new change in land ownership is again redefining ranchers' lives. It's a good news, bad news scenario. Around the Badlands, ranchers who have land to sell can divide it into 40-acre ranchettes for vacation property and get about $1,000 an acre. The bad news is, ranchers can't afford those prices. And John Hansen says it may have long-term effects on the grasslands.
It's environmentally devastating. It changes the open space. Many people, they have the dream, and justifiably so, of having their Western horse ranch. And so they get a 40-acre piece of ground and innocently probably graze it out year after year after year. The environment is changed. It's degraded, significantly degraded.
Our ranches are going to outside interests for recreation and other things, and there's no young people can afford to buy a ranch and make it pay. It's hard to see, because the country needs young families and business people on it, and we're going away from that.
Bill Lohman has also seen this change in land ownership around the Lohman Ranch near Sentinel Butte.
America was built on common sense, and we're losing that, and rural America is where the foundation of common sense. Our nearest neighbor is 7 miles away. That's our nearest neighbor. That's in one direction. There's federal land on three sides of us. We neighbor with neighbors 30, 40, 50 miles away, and they're next door neighbors to us. There used to be 60 mailboxes at our Westerham community mailbox, end of the route, 3 miles from the ranch here, back in the homestead days. Now there's one mailbox that my wife and I and my mother get our mail at. We're survivors out here in ranching in the Badlands. We're survivors. That's basically what ranching's about. You learn to improvise and use old equipment and scrounge here and there as long as you don't cheat on your cows. We work alone a lot. That's why I got into writing stories and doing poetry, because we have a lot of free mental time.
When out of that lonely, dark morning, an hour to the preside of daylight, a red light appeared in my mirror, then rapidly came into sight. In an instant, my heart had went skyward.
Bill Oman's poetry has become one of the tools he uses in his family survival on the ranch. He's turned his cowboy poetry into a business, giving banquet goers a side dish of humor to go with their meat and potatoes.
I couldn't believe it. When I pulled over, that trooper swung in behind me instead. I protested his display of injustice, of how the lead man got away, but he just smiled as he wrote out my ticket. Then I heard him say to us, "This man is a hero. He brings revenue into our state. He works the sale every Monday at Bowman. And damn, he sure is good bait."
There's always funny happenings, and I make the mistake of writing them down. I carry a notebook and keep notes all the time. Some of the poems will write themselves so fast, you got to shut down and write them down. They write themselves so fast, you can barely get them wrote down. And those are usually the good ones, because they're spontaneous.
But yeah, through the 80s, man, through the 80s, we were dry. I hooked the baler up, and I made a half a bale in June. And then we got some shower on a little patch of millet, and I finished it in August. I mean, it was dry.
I hate gossips. Gossips are my pet peeve, but yet I can go into the little town coffee shop and sit in on their gossip stations, come home, write a poem about it, give it back to them, and then they look up to me, because it's an art form then. It's not gossip. It's a piece of art. I have a good friend in the Sandals, Nebraska, and this is pretty basic. But it happened to him. It's worth telling, and he won't tell it, so I have to. And I wrote a poem. I call it Gold Rush. It's one of my earlier poems. At Sunday dinner, he bowed his head. In a short while, the prayers were said. Pass the steak. Potatoes, too. Roasting ears from the garden brand new. With a swaller, he knew something went bad. It was the only gold filling that he ever had. Well, now a secret worth keeping has got to be told. Every morning in there, he's panning for gold. Keeping a check, hoping it'll pass. Every time he tries, it's mostly gas. He turned 49 when he hit the sack. About a gold rush, there's lots of flack. But from the bathroom he came, looking forlorn. He thought he'd struck gold. It was only corn.
Cowboy poetry is only one of the Lowman's side businesses. Like other ranchers, they not only manage more cattle than their parents did, they manage a tighter schedule.
I'm managing time. I've got four businesses. I've got the ranch, I've got a dirt construction business, I've got a hunting lodge, and I've got entertainment business. So basically, as laid back as our lifestyle should be out here, it isn't normal for me because I've got three other occupations besides the ranching. The toughest thing would be financial pressures on bad years, dry years, big payments. Payments have to be made whether you're dried out or not, or equipment breaks down. Financial pressures constantly. You have to learn to put them in the back of your mind and do the best you can. Otherwise, you'll get ulcers. They'll get you down. Ag's always a fight. You gotta like it and like that way of life, or you won't stay in it. It's a good way of life, but it's tough. It's a survival of wills.
It's a lot of heart and a lot of dedication, and some people it might seem fun, but there's a lot of hardships and you need to have a strong heart to get through it all. God's help. You have to have a lot of faith, I guess, because it gets tough and gets discouraging, but it's just what you do. It's who you are. It's bred into you.
Paula Joel Wolf represents the next generation on the Wolf Ranch.
Yep, she wants to be a rancher. And my wife is thinking, oh God, them kids want to be ranchers now too. And
Paula, we're gonna keep him, so.
God willing, hopefully I can come back and be a rancher.
Help your guys, woo!
If Paula Joel does ranch, her father Shane will probably have to help her get started, just like his father helped him.
Dad could probably sold the place and been cashed up, but he helped me and my brother out a lot.
The rancher of the future will need to rely heavily on research and new technology.
Right now I'm going to school at NDSU in animal and range science with an emphasis on range. Going to school I think helps because now ranching has been more competitive and you really need genetics and you need to learn about it and starting to bring in a lot of new technology. And you can't farm and ranch like how your grandpa did.
I got her.
But her best teacher has always been the one at home, Dad.
Biggest thing is just raising a good family around this country.
He was always real encouraging. He's like, Paula Joel, get over here and try this. And he helped me, he taught me everything. So he's taught me a lot of stuff.
One of the skills Shane taught her was the fine art of castration.
I started a little bit last year. I saw my dad do it, you know, and it's just kind of to me, it's always kind of been a prestigious job because my dad did it, and I always thought, oh, that's pretty neat. And so I did it a few times last year, and then earlier this spring, my grandpa said, no, girls can't do that. And that just kind of fired me up more to do it. And I was like, you just watch me. So I did it, and it's just, I don't know, it's just kind of neat to show that women can do that too. And a lot of guys get scared of me, so stay on top of my game.
Ranchers are willing to make sacrifices and put up with the uncertainty of today, because tomorrow is what really matters.
You'll have a lot of cash, but you also hope someday you get equity built up in your land. I'll have something to give to my kids and keep this ranch going.
I hope our kids carry on some of what we do and pass it on to their kids.
All my nephews and nieces help. They're all trained in ranching. And if our kids don't take over, some of those kids will. It'll keep going.
I look at trying to build a better beef business than what my dad handed me to my kids, to where they want to come home and say, I got to work hard, but I get rewarded fairly for what I do.
Well, the best thing about here is just you're out in nice cool air, smelling the breeze and no pollution, and you're out, I guess, with just you and nature and God, really.
It's just a good life.
Find out how to purchase a copy of Ranching Perspectives. Call 1-800-359-6900.
This program was brought to you with a grant from the United States Department of Agriculture, Rural Development, and by the members of Prairie Public. For more information on Ranching Perspectives, visit our website at prairiepublic.org.